Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open. All desires known and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Have they been selected in accordance with the canons of this church? And do you believe their manner of life to be suitable to the exercise of this ministry? Will you be loyal to the doctrine, discipline, and worship of Christ as this church has received them? And will you, in accordance with the canons of this church, obey your bishop and other ministers who may have authority over you and your work? Dear friends in Christ, you know the importance of this ministry and the weight of your responsibility in presenting Samson Mamour, Cara Ellen Modisett, and William Westwood Yagel for ordination to the Sacred Order of Deacons. Therefore, if any of you know any impediment or crime because of which we should not proceed, come forward now and make it known. Is it your will that Samson, Cara, and William be ordained as deacons?
Yes.
Will you uphold them in this ministry?
We will.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
church, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That they may faithfully fulfill the duties of this ministry, build up your church, and glorify your name, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That by the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, they may be sustained and encouraged to persevere to the end, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For their families, that they may be adorned with all Christian virtues, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease, and that all may be as one, or that all may be one, as you and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who do not yet believe, and for those who have lost their faith, that they may receive the light of the gospel, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those in positions of public trust, especially the President of the United States and the Governor of Virginia, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a blessing upon all human labor and for the right use of the riches of creation, that the world may be freed from poverty, famine, and disaster, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all places in the world where there is conflict, violence, war, and inequity, especially for the people of Ukraine and Russia, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an end to the pandemics of COVID-19, racism, and gun violence, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For ourselves, for the forgiveness of sins, and for the grace of the Holy Spirit to amend our lives, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God. To you, O Lord our God. Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Jeremiah. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." Then I said, "Ah, Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say I am only a boy, for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord." Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, "Now I have put my words in your mouth." The word of the Lord. The psalm appointed for this morning is 84, which we shall read by the half verse. How dear to me is your dwelling, O Lord of hosts. The sparrow has found her a house, and the swallow a nest where she may lay her young. Happy are they who dwell in your house. Happy are the people whose strength is in you. Those who go through the desolate valley will find it a place of springs. They will climb from height to height. Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Behold our defender, O God. For one day in your courts is better than 1,000 in my own room. For the Lord God is both sun and shield. No good thing will the Lord withhold. The Lord of hosts.
Our second reading is a reading from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Since it is by God's mercy that we are engaged in this ministry, we do not lose heart. We have renounced the shameful things that one hides. We refuse to practice cunning or to falsify God's word, but by the open statement of the truth, we commend ourselves to the conscience of everyone in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
To look.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
A dispute arose among the disciples as to which one of them was to be regarded as the greatest. But Jesus said to them, "The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Rather, the greatest among you must become like the youngest, and the leader like one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one who is at the table? But I am among you as one who serves." The Gospel of the Lord.
Nearer, my God, to thee, nearer, my God, to thee. Even if it be a cross that raises me, still all my song shall be is nearer, my God, to thee. You may be seated. Grace Church, it is indeed my pleasure to stand before you this wonderful, wonderful morning. My name is the Reverend Dr. Mark Andrew Jefferson, and I bring greetings from the Virginia Theological Seminary in Alexandria, Virginia. If you're going to clap, clap. At Virginia, I have the wonderful opportunity to teach preaching there. And it is in that space that I've met those that we see before us today. As a professor, it is one of the most rewarding experiences to see students take that next step into the journey of their own ministry. So I'm honored for the invitation. Thank you, Bishop. Thank you for all those who made this opportunity possible. I do not want to belabor our time, but I also want to thank you. Our seminary turns 200 years old next year. And for that occasion, I was asked to preach 200 sermons around the world to commemorate this opportunity. I know, right? Yeah. So since October of 2018, I've been traversing the country and even the world, preaching the gospel to places just like this. And it has done my heart such good to be able to be with Christians during some of the most isolating and difficult times. So to be with you on this journey and to carve off another sermon on the list, I am eternally grateful to you. So I believe this is sermon 192. So we are moving our way down the field. So I'm very grateful for that. I don't want to belabor our time. I want to make sure that we honor the occasion that's here. I want to lift up one verse for our time today, and then we'll kind of deal with the rest of the readings after that. And it reads from the Gospel of Luke, "A dispute arose among them as to which one of them was to be regarded as the greatest. A dispute also arose among them as to which one of them was to be regarded as the greatest." For the time that's ours this morning, I'd like to briefly share with you from this thought, hypnotized by low-hanging fruit. Hypnotized by low-hanging fruit. You would imagine that those who understood the serious nature of the moment would be the most focused. In the succeeding chapters, we see that Jesus' earthly life is rapidly coming to an end, as that interlocking relationship between politics and religion began to move in a more auspicious way so that they could bring the life of Jesus of Nazareth to a conclusion. It is this life that has healed the sick, exorcised individual and communal demons. It is this Jesus who has fed the hungry and helped to provide respite for those of spiritual dehydration. He provided himself to be living water and to be the bread of life. And for such gifts he's given to this fallen world, the gift they gave to him was a death sentence from an unjust system that sought to make him guilty before he began. And so we find that Jesus sees the end of his life and he is gathered around. He's huddled up with those who he's been doing ministry with. It befuddles me sometimes to think that why would God take such a ragtag, out of sort, mismatched group of folks and do ministry with them? Maybe that brings us hope today as we see ourselves, some of us wearing red, thinking of the ways in which we've been called to do the work of ministry, knowing that it is not our strength that gives us the space to stand, but in fact, it is the strength of God standing up in and through us that qualifies us for such a difficult task. But I can imagine that these disciples were looking for some sort of distraction. They understood, they may have felt the gravity of what was happening. They were being called from the periphery to the center. They were being called from the periphery of Jerusalem now to the center. And as the book of Acts begins to roll out from Jerusalem to the world, so Jesus taking these provincial, seemingly unqualified preachers and making them deputies of the gospel seems to be strange. And you would think that for such an awesome gift, they would have undivided focus about bringing God's will into being. And at this critical juncture where Jesus is marshaling the troops, there's ascension in the ranks. Because as a group of them, they were trying to discern which one of them was the greatest. The greatest. This conversation seems like fodder for a sports talk or CNN or Fox News. Who is the greatest? But it is in this question that leads us to this low-hanging fruit. Because when we are faced with the opportunity to be Christians in a fallen world, the invitation for us to argue about who is greater seems to take hold. Which denomination is greater? Which diocese is greater? Which preacher is greater? Which model of ministry is greater? So much so that greater becomes the pursuit in and of itself. Almost decontextualizing us from a world that is falling apart. War, rumor of war, pestilence, strife, dissension and the disintegration of family and relationships, but yet people are arguing about who's greater. Do we not see the state of the world? But the conversation in Christian enclaves is not about how can we be more Christ-like. But when we have a chance to see the expanse of God's creation and to see our role in it, when we look out, we find ourselves seduced by lesser things and hypnotized by low-hanging fruit. It seems that Jesus is critiquing this thought of greatness by turning it upside down. Jesus is saying to them that you who think you're great, arguing for greatness, trying to delineate yourself from your neighbor, are missing the point because I am the one that just washed your feet. Amen. You can't face one another, but the God of all creation was willing to face our feet. And so this dissension begins to bubble up all the more until Jesus, who has one eye on death, has to take his attention off of that to deal with disciples who refuse to be focused on the task at hand. They're too busy taking Facebook selfies and Instagram snapshots. They want to know who has the most likes, who's the most beloved, and not who's the most useful for the kingdom. We are getting deeper into what I'm finding to be the question of our age as clergy. What do we do when our dust dusts up? Because this is clergy beef in the text. This is clergy strife in the text. This is not the 5,000. This is not the 4,000. This is preachers not getting along because they took their eye off the ball. Instead of running for an endowment in a big steeple, they found themselves looking for what would authenticate them to the outside world. When in actuality, the authenticator of their mission is calling their mission into question. It seems that they lost their sense of perspective. So when we read in 2 Corinthians what Paul is writing to the church in Corinth about, he's trying to get them to understand that there's something special on the inside of us. But we so often are willing to trade that for the illusion of greatness that we end up apprehending the superficial and left wanting for the eternal. We find ourselves seeking to make sense of a world that's fallen by trying to be the greatest one in a fallen world. And now, the gospel of Jesus Christ and those who are supposed to proclaim it and those who are supposed to live it out are having to ask questions about who they're going to be in a world like this. So when we turn to Jeremiah, I find this so compelling. Because Jeremiah understood that his life was being called into question in a time in which his people needed that witness. So instead of him being hypnotized about being great, he wanted to get a deeper sense of why is he doing this? Why is he sacrificing his comfort? Why is he sacrificing his life and lifestyle? Why is he willing to face death for people who aren't even sure if they want to live? Jeremiah seemingly has this downloaded back into his spirit. Before, I like that word. Before, it's not just in terms of language, but it makes a theological statement. Before Jeremiah, you showed up, I was already at work. Before you were thought about, I already had you in my mind. Before you even doubted yourself, I already called confidence out of you. It is in this space that we as Christians, whether you have a collar on or you don't, we are all proclaimed, we are all invited to proclaim our Christian faith. So preaching is for all of us. But this preaching is predicated on the fact that God called us into this work. So therefore, all we have to do is respond in kind. The strength of the one who calls makes the one who's receiving the call more confident. Because the receiver of the call is not the authenticator of the call. So when we remember who has called us into this work, we are then reminded about the long-term scope of God's work in the world. It raises our eyes from being superficially hypnotized by the low-hanging fruit of our world. Who won the election? Who's the CEO of the corporation? All of these things change, but yet we're still asking who's the greatest. My sister and my brother, we are gathered here to be of use to the kingdom. We're gathered here because it is something about the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ that turned the world upside down. But unfortunately, we have become so accustomed to managing God's miracles that instead of turning the world upside down, we're trying to make peace with the world that we have. Maybe peace is not to be made with this world, my friends. For Jesus had the opportunity to make peace with the world. He was presented with a temptation. If you would bow down and worship me, so says Satan. Jesus, I'll give you the ability to be the ruler of this lower domain, as I have been given power. We hear and see this same power dynamic shift in the text, because Jesus turning down that temptation, knowing that this is his world once he goes through the proper channels, and skipping the shortcut of bowing the knee to this age. But now his disciples are faced with that same temptation. Do I live to be at peace with this world and be like the kings who are actually being ruled by the people who put them in power? Or am I empowered by the gospel itself? Jesus is saying to them, the gospel that I've given you, this love that I've given you, is so robust, I don't want you to trade it in by subjugating it to what the world would tell you to do. Because the kings that you worship have to bow down to someone else. But Jesus said, I came to give you life and to give you that life more abundantly. And our job was to bear witness to this abundance. For those of you who take this big step today, there's going to be times when clergy dust up. There's going to be times in which, I know, it happens. There's going to be times in which Christians aren't acting like Christians. There's going to be times in your ministry where the church and the world will seem indistinguishable from one another. But your job is to be like Jeremiah and to bear witness in the face of hard lies and soft truths. You're supposed to bear witness in a world that loves darkness and death and offer them life in that more abundant. Not to be hypnotized by who's up and who's down. The question that we all must face is who is Jesus Christ for us today? And what does that mean for us? We're being invited to lift up our eyes beyond the hills of our existential experience, beyond the limitations of our views, and beyond the ways in which we are inhospitable to neighbor and self in the world. As gun violence and people dying, as drug violence and people are dying, as we continue to neglect homeless and hungry people and they're dying, as we continue to see a world that's dying, we're asked to preach and be life. And it is to this that we all will support you. It is to the life-giving work of Jesus Christ that we all give assent. And it's to this gospel that you give your entire life. And if you, like the example of Jesus, are willing to give your very best, the world will be changed. Roanoke will be changed. Staunton will be changed. Lexington will be changed. Southwestern Virginia will be changed. And how goes Virginia, goes the country. I'm a Virginian friend. I'm telling you what I know. So if how the state provides insight to how the nation goes, then each pulpit that we take is a small slice of the past, the present, and the future. Go with the God that's already gone ahead of you. Preach the gospel that's already inside of you. And turn this place upside down, right side up, for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us stand and affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth.
All things seen and unseen. We believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, begotten of the Father, God of God, light from light, true God from true God.
My sister and my brothers, every Christian is called to follow Jesus Christ, serving God the Father through the power of the Holy Spirit. God now calls you to a special ministry of servanthood directly under your bishop. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are to serve all people, particularly the poor, the weak, the sick, and the lonely. As a deacon in the church, you are to study Holy Scriptures, to seek nourishment from them, and to model your life upon them. You are to make Christ and his redemptive love known by your word and example to those among whom you live and work and worship. You too are to interpret to the church the needs, concerns, and hopes of the world. You are to assist the bishop and priests in public worship and in the ministration of God's word and sacraments. And you are to carry out other duties assigned to you from time to time. At all times, your life and teaching are to show to Christ's people that in serving the helpless, they are serving Christ himself. My sister and my brothers, do you believe that you are truly called by God and his church to the life and work of a deacon?
I believe I am so called.
Do you now, in the presence of the church, commit yourself to this trust and responsibility? Will you be guided by the pastoral direction and leadership of your bishop?
I will.
Will you be faithful in prayer and in the reading and study of Holy Scriptures?
I will.
Will you look for Christ in all others, being ready to help and serve those in need?
I will.
Will you do your best to pattern your life and that of your family in accordance with the teachings of Christ, so that you may be a wholesome example to all people? Will you in all things seek not your glory, but the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ? May the Lord by his grace uphold you in his service that he lays upon you. O God, most merciful Father, we praise you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, who took on himself the form of a servant and humbled himself, becoming obedient even to death on the cross. We praise you that you have highly exalted him and made him Lord of all, and that through him we know that whoever would be great must be servant of all. We praise you for the many ministries of your church and for calling these your servants to the order of deacons. Therefore, Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, give your Holy Spirit to Samson. Fill him with grace and power, and make him a deacon in your church. Therefore, Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, give your Holy Spirit to Cara. Fill her with grace and power, and make her a deacon in your church. Therefore, Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, give your Holy Spirit to William. Fill him with grace and power, and make him a deacon in your church. Make them, O Lord, modest and humble, strong and constant to observe the discipline of Christ. Let their lives and teachings so reflect your commandments that through them many may come to know you and love you. As your Son came not to be served but to serve, may these deacons share in Christ's service and come to the unending glory of him who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
Okay. You all can be seated. Samson, receive this Bible as a sign of your authority to proclaim God's word and to assist in the ministration of his holy sacraments. Cara, receive this Bible as a sign of your authority to proclaim God's word and to assist in the ministration of his holy sacraments. William, receive this Bible as a sign of your authority to proclaim God's word and to assist in the ministration of his holy sacraments. Let us all now welcome the newest deacons in the Episcopal Church. The peace of the Lord be always with you. You all may be seated. I invite those. I don't know whether that's me doing this thing to the microphone or the microphone. It's me? What am I doing? What am I doing or not doing? So I would invite the rector of this parish, Bower Pine, to welcome you. Go ahead.
Welcome to Grace Episcopal Church, Lexington. We're so glad that you're here. I know most of you have your phones up. I hope you'll feel free to post to someone some way in which you felt and witnessed the love of God here, and a way that you that you're inspired to show the love of God to the world. But if you're not willing to post that, just post that you were here. you're part of something today that God is doing in the world. We're so honored and pleased to be able to welcome Samson to serve here as a deacon. And we will continue to pray for Cara and William as they go to Stanton and Bradford. After the service, everyone is welcome to join in a reception. I have to tell you, all the power went out in a lot of our homes last night. And I know that some of the people who had chicken salad stored up in their refrigerators threw it all out this morning. So some of them went out and they made completely new stuff. We hope that whatever is out there you will enjoy, and that you won't leave it anything there for us to clean up except the plate. If you need help finding a restroom or something like that, one of the ushers, people wearing a name tag like this, will help you find that in parts of the building. But we're glad that you're here.
Thank you, Tug. And thank you to the people of Grace, Lexington, to this church on this really pretty momentous and big day in the life of our diocese. This is the largest class of ordinands that I have ordained since I've been here. I've had some ones and twos, but not three. And each of you represent a lot of threads being pulled through this diocese. There are many people here that you know, are connected to one or all of you. And it's a really big day to be in this church that's newly renovated and beautiful. And our preacher being in this pulpit will not be lost on many of you. The sign of the ongoing work of the Holy Spirit's reconciliation in our lives. And these three ordinands, again, I've known them from the beginning of now my 10-year ministry almost. Samson from very early days at the Sudanese ministry at St. James in Roanoke, the people that he led and raised up there. I've known Cara since the first day that I actually entered the diocese, because she was a communicator arranging the beginning of my own ordination. And I've known Samson from the days when he was at Trinity, when Mark was the rector there, when Canon Furlow was the rector there, getting oysters together and locking and those things. So these three have traveled long journey to this day, and we are all blessed in this diocese and in this church. It's our great blessing to have even one of our former bishops with us, and Bishop Light here, to signify what a joyous and great blessing this day is. Walk in love as Christ loved us, gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God. And to do that, there's a QR code in the bulletin and some other ways that you can put your folding money or your credit card to use.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise.
Glory to you forever and ever.
At your command, all things came to be, the vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home. From the primal elements, you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another. Again and again, you called us to return. Through prophets and sages, you revealed your righteous law, and in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son, born of a woman to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace. And therefore we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, martyrs, and with those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory and their unending hymn. And so, Father, we who have been redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption, and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving, Lord God of our fathers and mothers, gods of Abraham, Sarah, Isaac, Rebekah, Jacob, Leah, and Rachel, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this holy communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name. Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great high priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit, your church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. The kingdom, power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Taste and see that God is good, the gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Almighty Father, we thank you for feeding us with the holy food of the body and blood of your Son, and for uniting us through him in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. We thank you for raising up among us faithful servants for the ministry of your word and sacraments. Pray that Samson, Cara, and William may be to us effective examples in word and action, in love and patience, and in holiness of life. Grant that we with them may serve you now and always rejoice in your glory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, lives and reigns with you, Holy Spirit, and God, forever and forever. Amen. Blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and forever. Amen. Just stand right back there and we'll all go out together.